Okay, we will get started. So, we'll continue our discussion about KKT conditions. Okay, and the problem setting is we want to minimize f of x such that x is in Rn, h of x is equal to 0 or hi of x equal to 0, I equals 1 to m, and gj of x is less than equal to 0, j equals 1 to r. The class has started. Okay, so this is the problem setting that we are considering. So we now have we have inequality constraint now. Whereas in the Lagrange multiplier theorem, we only had equality constraints. So we have another set of constraints in this problem. And what we were discussing in the previous class was this idea or this fact that if you consider this problem, minimization of fx such that h of x or hi of x equal to 0 and gj of x is equal to 0 for all j in the set of active constraints at x star, okay, where x star is the solution to this problem. So x star so if x star is a solution to this problem, then x star is also a solution to this problem. Okay, so the fact was, this was number 2, number 1. So the fact is, or the claim is, if x star optimal for 1, then x star optimal for 2. Okay, and if you want to visualize it, let's say you are minimizing a function in this region. So this is my x1 or let's say I'm trying to minimize the region. So my region is x greater than equal to 0 and I want to minimize the function. So that's this entire plane, okay, not this side. And this, what is this surface? This surface is x2 equal to 0 and this surface is x1 equal to 0. Okay? And let's say this is my optimal point. Okay? I don't have any equality constraint here. Okay? So I'm minimizing a function in two dimension. This is the plane x2 equal to 0. This is the plane x1 equal to 0 and my constraint set is x greater than equal to 0 and my x star lies here, that is on x axis or in x1 axis, where x2 is equal to 0. Okay, my claim is that what I'm claiming here in this fact is, suppose I remove this constraint. Okay, and I remove all these constraints. Okay, so I'm just concentrating on this line. And what I'm claiming is, if x star is locally optimal for 1, okay, there should be locally optimal here. Okay, then x star is also locally optimal just along this line. Okay, why? So if I'm contracting the set, then of course, if x star was locally optimal in the larger set, then it has to be locally optimal in the smaller set as well. Okay, so that's what I'm claiming in this particular fact. Okay, are you convinced? Are you convinced of this? Okay, proof by figure. So, what do we have to do? So, we know that So we know that from Lagrange multiplier theorem, we know the solution, we know what the necessary condition is if we had equality constraint. But now we have inequality constraint, but here is an idea. We can transform this problem into an equality constraint problem and then look at the necessary condition for optimality in this problem. Okay, so if x star is locally optimal for 1, then x star is locally optimal for 2, and x star should satisfy the necessary condition for optimality for 2. Okay, that's the train of thought. Okay, so then x star is optimal for 2, and this implies that x star should satisfy Lagrange multiplier theorem for 2. And that's exactly what, well, not exactly, Kekeri condition is slightly more, but that's pretty much what the underlying idea of Kekeri condition is. So x star is optimal or local minimum and regular. Oh, have I defined regularity so far? I probably have not. Let me define regularity. So definition, x is regular if gradient of h1 at x, gradient of hm of x, and gradient of gj of x, where j is in the set of active constraints of x. So I look at the set of vectors and they should be are linearly independent set of vectors. Okay, that's the definition of regularity. And let me also define Lagrangian for this problem. So L of x lambda mu, that's given by f of x plus summation lambda I hi of x, I equals 1 to m, plus summation mu j gj of x, j equals 1 to r. Okay, so this is my Lagrangian for this problem. And so my KKT theorem, by the way, KKT stands for Karush, Kun and Tucker. Okay, KKT theorem. Those of you who might be taking game theory, you know that Kun and Tucker, they are one of the founding fathers of game theory. One, I mean, there are many, but they have made seminal contributions to game theory as well. Okay, I think Karush, in his master's thesis in 1939 or 1940s, he came up with these conditions. And Kun and Tucker independently came up with these conditions later on in 1950s. That's why it's called Kekeri condition, to honor them. So x star is optimal or local, is a local minimum and regular, implies there exist lambda star in Rm and mu star in R such that first is gradient with respect to x of L evaluated at x star lambda star mu star is greater, no, is equal to 0, mu j star is greater than equal to 0, mu j star is equal to 0 for all j that are not in the set of active constraints at x. Okay, so these are known as KKT condition. And you might have seen it in many papers, if you have started reading optimization papers already. Okay, so these are called KKT conditions. So if X star is local minimum and regular, there exist Lagrange multipliers. So these are called Lagrange multipliers. Okay, so there exist Lagrange multipliers, lambda star and mu star, where mu star is greater than equal to 0, mu j star is equal to 0 only if j is not active at x star, and the gradient of the Lagrangian with respect to x should be equal to 0. Okay, further, d transpose second derivative of L at x star, lambda star, mu star, d has to be greater than or equal to 0 for all d in V x star. And what is V x star here? It's the set of all d such that gradient hi you will see the result that is extremely similar to what you saw in Lagrange multiplier theorem. Any questions on this? Okay, so for all I, gradient of HI should be orthogonal to D, and for all J that is in the set of active constraints, gradient of GJ should be orthogonal to D. Okay, that's the set of first order feasible variations, and it should satisfy this positive semi-definiteness condition along this subspace. How many of you have heard of KKT conditions before? Many. Okay, so you might have seen it many papers. But it's a necessary condition for optimality. So just because something is, some problem satisfies, I mean some set of points satisfy KKT condition doesn't really mean that it's optimal. All it means is it's a candidate for locally optimal solution. And the sufficiency condition is also similar. All you have to do is, well, let me write the sufficiency condition. Any questions on this part, this side? No? It's just definition. So, second order sufficient condition, if x bar, lambda bar, mu bar satisfy one, x bar is regular, 2, x bar, lambda bar, mu bar satisfy KKT conditions. And D transpose second derivative of L at x bar, lambda bar, mu bar, D strictly positive for all D in Vx star, D not equal to 0, then x bar is locally optimal. Actually, you know, it's strict local minimum in this case. So it's just not just a local minimum, but it's strictly local minimum. So how do we go about proving the KKT result? So this is sufficiency condition. Okay, this is something that you need to check. So if you know a set of points that satisfy KKT conditions, well, it's a candidate local minimum. You put it here. You put those points here. Does it satisfy KKT conditions? Yes. Is it regular? Yes. Is this second order condition satisfied? Yes. Then good. You are at a local minimum. Okay. Now the question is, yeah, you have a question? No, function. This is for one. Yeah, locally optimal for one. Any other question? Okay, so let's. I mean, we are not going to go and prove the KKT conditions again, because it's similar to the Lagrange multiplier, the penalty approach for Lagrange multiplier theorem that we had done in the classroom. So, but I still want to give you an intuition about how do you go about proving this result. So what you have to do is, well, remember we constructed this function fk of x, which is f of x plus lambda transpose, no, there was no lambda transpose h of x, k norm of h of x square over 2 plus alpha over 2 norm of x minus x star square. Okay, this is what we started with. Alpha was a strictly positive parameter and k was a natural number. Okay, so we indexed this function fk with k. So this was a penalty function, right? This was a penalty added to violate. So if you violate the constraint, hx was supposed to be equal to 0. If you violate this constraint, then you put a penalty in the cost function. And so it turned out that if you solve this problem and take the sequence going to infinity, so you get the minimum of fk, unconstrained minimum of fk, and you let k go to infinity, you approach x star, okay? Now, how would we transform this penalty function in such a way that we can take care of the inequality constraint? What should we do? So I want to come up with a penalty function that penalizes violating this constraint. Okay? What changes can I make to this penalty function to reflect that? Any thoughts? So if gx is less than 0, we are fine. But if gx is greater than 0, then a penalty should be added there. So we just can't take the norm of gx. Okay, so we can't add k over 2 norm of gx square. I mean, this will not work, right? Because it will penalize. If gx is negative, it's going to penalize it. We don't want it to be penalized. So what should we do? Thoughts? Sorry? Slack variable. No, it can be done without that. That's an option, but then you are transforming this problem into an equality constraint problem. Can we do something without adding a slack variable? That's certainly an option, but that's not really that direct. You're increasing the dimension of the problem by adding slack variables. Sorry? Sine function. Okay. Well, you are close, but not there yet. Sine function is not a continuous function. It's a discontinuous function at zero. Softmax. Okay. Many of you would have heard the term. Zero gj of x square, and then you sum over j equals 1 to r. Sorry? Right. That's very similar to this. Okay, so this is max of 0 comma gj of x. So this is continuous. Okay, so you can do things like gradient descent and so on. Well, it's not differentiable, but only it's not differentiable only at 0, right? Assuming that it may be differentiable at 0 if gj prime of x star is equal to 0, but it may not be, right? It may not be differentiable at 0, but it's fine. Okay, it could be something like this. So it's differentiable here, it's differentiable here, it's only one point at which it's not differentiable. But it's fine, we can take care of that. We can still run the gradient descent if we have to. Well, it doesn't need to be same, but what you can do is have different coefficients that are all indexed by k, but they all have to go to infinity as k goes to infinity. So you want the penalty to grow as k goes to infinity, okay? And then you do the same approach. You find the unconstrained minimum of fk of x, okay? Remember, we started with a constraint problem, but now we're solving an unconstrained problem. So we find a minimum of this function in a ball around x star, and then we let k go to infinity, and you will see that the minimum point xk will converge to x star, and then you prove some result. And in particular, your lambda star or lambda I star is limit k goes to infinity k hi xk, and your mu j star is limit k go to infinity k gj plus x star or xk. Okay, gj plus is this function. This is my gj plus x. Okay. So do we get all of this? Can we claim that all of them are true? Well, the first one is fine, not a big deal. We can prove it because it's an unconstrained, xk is unconstrained minimum to fk of x. So let k go to infinity, you will arrive at this result. So gradient of f of k xk will be equal to 0. Let k go to infinity, you arrive at this result. Well, let me just write it. Limit k goes to infinity, gradient of f evaluated at x, fk evaluated at xk is equal to 0. That would give you the first result. Can we get the second result by looking at this expression? So what is the sign of gj plus of xk? It's always non-negative, right? Non-negative. So we get this result. K is non-negative. This is non-negative. Take the limit of non-negative sequence, you get a positive number. So k gj plus xk is greater than or equal to 0. What about third result? How do we prove that? So for all j that is not in the set of active constraint, how do I prove that mu j star is going to be equal to 0? What is gj of x star? Gj plus of x star. Okay, remember that j doesn't satisfy, j is not in the set of active constraints. Okay, so if it is not in the set of active constraints, it means gj of x star is strictly negative, right? If it is strictly negative, then gj plus of x is 0, right? So what we have is gj plus of xk is equal to 0 if for all j not in active constraint. Okay, for k sufficiently large. So then you take the limit k going to infinity, you get that mu j star should be equal to 0. That's the basic intuition behind these three conditions, these three KKD conditions. Any question on that? Okay, this is the penalty approach to proving KKD condition. So that's the if you write down the complete proof, which is by the way given in the book, so if you're interested you can go and read it, but I think I've covered the basic idea in the proof, and it's very similar to the Lagrange multiplier theorem result. Any question? Yeah. Negative? Okay. How do we define the set of active constraint? How do I define the set of active constraints? So A of x star is the index j such that gj of x star is equal to 0. Right? So you know that x star satisfies gj of x star is less than or equal to 0. So if j is not in this set, then gj of x star has to be strictly negative. So we know that gj of x star is less than or equal to 0, because that's the constraint, right? So if x star is not in this, if j is not in this set, then it has to be strictly negative. Okay? And so if j not in ax star, then gj x star is strictly negative, which implies gj plus x star is equal to 0. Okay? Any other question? Okay. There is another set of necessary condition. Oh, by the way, sensitivity theorem. Okay. Sensitivity theorem holds here as well. Sensitivity theorem. So the setting is you define P u v as minimum value of f x such that h x is equal to u and g x is less than equal to v. And sensitivity theorem says that x star optimal and regular implies gradient of P u v with respect to u is minus lambda star u v and gradient of v of P u v equals minus mu star of u comma v. Okay, and we had seen how sensitivity theorem can be used to estimate the reduction in function as you relax the constraint set or as you make the constraint set more smaller or larger. Okay, so it's very useful, especially if you want to get some estimate of how the function is going to change. If you move, if you change the constraints by a little bit. It gives you a very good idea. By the way, in the first assignment, if you remember, you had computed this lambda star, right, in lambda 1 and lambda 2, right? So it was actually a Lagrange multiplier for the constraint optimization problem that you had formulated. And what the sensitivity theorem says is the change in cost, if you move the demand by a little bit, is exactly the same as lambda star. Okay, so it's marginal cost of production. So in that problem, lambda star was the same as lambda star was exactly equal to how much it would cost to generate one extra watt of electricity, given the cost of the generators was C1 and C2. Okay, so that was the meaning of that particular problem. And it so turns out, even though we did not cover it, so it turns out that if you price the electricity at that point, so if the price of the electricity is lambda star, then it's in the best interest of every generator to produce exactly the amount of electricity that was socially optimal, okay, that was minimizing the overall cost function. So in economics, the sensitivity is known as marginal cost of production, and lambda star becomes the price, okay, the price of the good. And the idea is lambda star, if you keep the price equal to lambda star, it enforces a socially optimal behavior among all the market participants. Okay, and question one was a case where you could actually see it happening by doing the math. And that's how electricity markets actually work in the US and all over the place, all over the world. Okay, any question? No? So now I want to cover another set of necessary condition which is stronger than KKT condition. It's called Fritz-John theorem, and this is stronger than KKT condition. And Fritz-John theorem says if X star is optimal, then Okay, no regularity. Okay, no regularity assumption here. Well, I always want to say local minimum, but I end up saying optimal. Then there exists mu naught star greater than equal to 0, lambda star in Rm, mu star in R such that this is a scalar number, okay, this is a vector lambda star. Oh, I haven't defined the Lagrangian, let me write it completely. That will be mu naught star . So I've introduced another variable here, mu naught star, that has to be non-negative. And the fourth condition is a little technical. So I'll let you guys write other things. Okay, so what are the conditions? So what is the condition that's missing right now from the KKT condition? What have I not written so far? The fact that the mu j star is going to be equal to 0 for all j which is not active. So I'm not going to write that constraint here, that condition here, and instead I'm going to write something else. So that something else is, for every neighborhood n of x star, there exist x in n such that lambda I star h x or h I x is strictly positive if lambda I star was not equal to 0, and mu j star g j x is strictly positive if mu j star is not equal to 0. This x is same for all these inequalities. Okay, and let's say this is my constraint set. Okay, so I have to be on this particular line, and here is my optimal point x star. okay, and somebody gives me a neighborhood of x star, let's say I can pick any neighborhood, so I'm going to pick this neighborhood. So in every such neighborhood of x star, I can find a point x, okay, such that if I multiply lambda I star with hi of x, it's going to be strictly positive if lambda I star was not 0, and mu j star multiplied by gj of x is also going to be strictly positive. I mean, what this means is hi of x has the same sign as lambda I star, and gj of x has the same sign as mu j star. Okay, that's what these conditions mean, assuming that lambda I star and mu j star was non-zero to begin with. Okay, so it turns out that this condition is weaker than the KKT condition, because now you don't assume that x star is regular. Okay, you don't have to assume that x star is regular. If it so happens that x star was irregular, just a second. Yeah, if it so happens that x star was irregular, then you will have mu naught star will be equal to 0, right? And when it's okay, so these terms are linearly dependent, so you can find non-zeros lambda I star and mu j star so that this sum to 0. Okay, so regularity is not required for Fritz-John condition to hold.
So you say they're not all equal to 0, are you saying that most of them can be equal to 0 and only one needs to not be? Or?
Well, it, yes, that's what it means. Only one of them should be non-zero. Yeah. At least one non-zero element should be there in this set. At least one. Okay. You can have multiple. You can have all of them equal to 0, but one of them is non-zero. Okay. So regularity is not required for this. So let's say you have a problem. Somebody gave you an x star and said that, well, this is a candidate optimal solution. How would you check that? Well, the first thing you check is regularity. And you see, well, regularity is not satisfied at this point. So what do? You can't apply KKT condition. So then you say, well, for Fritz-John theorem, I don't need regularity. So if someone is claiming that X star is local minimum, all I have to do is construct this mu naught star, lambda star, mu star, so that these conditions are satisfied. Okay, so I don't care about regularity in this case. And if it is satisfied, well, it still remains a candidate optimal solution. If it is not satisfied, the person is lying. Okay? You can easily conclude that. And again, you can prove this using using penalty approach, but there is something more, some more trick that you need to work with in order to prove this part of the result. It's not as simple as the KKT theorem. Oh, the second thing is, if X star is indeed regular, then Fritz-John condition is the same as KKT condition. Okay, you can, if X star is regular, then from Fritz-John condition, Fritz-John theorem, you can prove KKT theorem easily. Is that clear? Any question? So I will just write it. If X star is regular, then Fritz-John implies KKT. In which case, mu naught star will be equal to 1. Okay, any question? In fact, in the KKT condition, You can remove the fact that mu j star is equal to 0 for all inactive constraints with this particular expression, and it would still hold. Now, in this book, there are a lot of other necessary as well as sufficient conditions for optimality given, but we are not going to consider any of that. I will not be covering any of that on the board because that's purely theoretical. So this is the last theory lecture ever. Well, not ever, but in this class. And then I'm going to skip chapter 3 and most of chapter 3. And we'll move on to chapter 4. And we'll talk about methods for solving optimization problems with equality and inequality constraints. Okay, general equality and inequality constraints. So they need not be convex, they need not be linear, they can be any arbitrary set of constraints. So how would you go about solving those problems? So that's what we are going to start from Friday onwards. Any question about that? No? Okay, so if everyone has understood everything in this class, then we are done. Thank you all for attending.